So we have talked about extraction, we have talked about cleanup, we talked about concentration. This is usually in this sequence, and there are a lot of QA/QC issues in this. You can imagine that you are taking a sample and doing a lot of processing with it. Sample can go, can get lost somewhere, and you can also add sample in which where you don't have. You have a solvent that is not clean, then you can get sample addition, all these things. So now we go down to the instrument itself, analysis. So we look at the different possibilities for analyzing organic chemicals. So this is just analytical chemistry, we are getting into that. The reasons why most of the methods, see, when you have environmental samples, inevitably environmental samples, you take air samples, solid samples, soil samples, water samples, the analytes are usually mixtures. You do not find one specific compound, only one compound sitting in a sample of water or air, it's very unlikely. Very rare, I am not even sure if it is possible. So they are usually mixtures, and you are, even if you are interested, typically we are interested in multiple analytes, yeah, but even if you are interested in one analyte, you are interested in one particular compound, whether it is there or how much of it is there in water or air, you still have to resolve all of it, okay. So you have to separate components of the mixture. And this is usually done using chromatography, the process of chromatography is used for doing this. So the chromatography itself is separation, it is not analysis, it is separation, separation of compound. You still need something to analyze the compound at the end of it, okay. So we will talk about that also. So there are different kinds of chromatography. One, the oldest type of chromatography, the older type of chromatography is called as liquid chromatography. The older type is called as LC. The more, the later development is called gas chromatography or GC. The word liquid or gas is very specific to one thing. So we look at chromatography itself, the process of chromatography, what it is, then we will appreciate what it means by this thing. So the chromatography, the separation is on the basis of, like what we do, what we have discussed, what we have been discussing in our course right from the beginning, based on relative affinity of the analyte between two phases. What does this mean, relative affinity of an analyte between two phases? Two phases means here, there are two phases, we are trying to separate the analyte that is there in one phase, we are trying to separate it from that phase. So we have to use another phase which is not miscible with this phase. The simplest thing that we can do is you bring it in contact with a solid and do separate it like that. You can also bring it in contact with a liquid, also do it. We have done it in liquid-liquid extraction or in the SPE case like that. So if you bring an analyte to and separate it, so we are talking about relative affinity. What are we really talking about? When we say relative affinity, what is a quantitative measure of that? You have seen that earlier in the course. Solubility is very specific. Solubility is from pure substance to this thing. So in this case, it is, it's in a solution or it's in a vapor phase. So it is the distribution or the partitioning of chemical between two phases. So it is the partition constant really. If the partitioning is between, we are really talking about Ka between the solid phase, between, let us make it simple, which is phase 1 and phase 2. So, why do we need this relative affinity? It is the following. So, chromatography, as we saw in the case of liquid chromatography or what is called as column chromatography, which is the older method, it was the oldest form, and you have studied chromatography one way or the other from school. So, you need something called as the stationary phase. So, for convenience, so the two phases, it is convenient if one phase is solid or a stationary phase and the other phase is a mobile phase, is a fluid. So, this is a solid phase, it is sitting here. The easiest way a solid phase can be arranged is you take some solid, make a packing of it. Let us say I am taking some solid particles, putting it here. So, I can make soil itself like soil, solid particle. Then I need a mobile phase. The mobile phase is a liquid that is flowing through this continuously. Okay. Then if I introduce a mixture, we will call it as AI, where I goes from 1 to N, mixture of N components, N number of analytes are there in this, is a mixture here, so we will give it a color. This one, and we continue the mobile phase. The mobile phase is continuing to go through. So what will happen is this will go through. This will go through this thing and appear out here. Okay, so the mobile phase comes out. Will come out. If the partitioning of a particular analyte is very high on the solid phase, if this K is high, what will happen to the analyte? What will happen to analyte? It will adsorb onto the solid phase and it will stay there. So let us say that it takes tau, the residence time, the residence time of a flow, mobile phase is being sent at some flow rate, it is coming through. If I add mobile phase here, it will appear here at the end in some residence time tau. Let us not worry about how tau is calculated for the time being or what it is, it is not important for this discussion, but there are ways to calculate it. The residence time is the liquid, as the liquid starts here and goes through it, there is a residence time. The liquid is not doing it, liquid is just going through nicely. But say there is an analyte A1 which has high K, let us call it as KASM, solid phase and mobile phase, which is called, we call this as KASM star, which high KASM star, and there is another chemical A2 which has very low KASM star, which one will appear out of the column quickly? Let us say a chemical has no accumulation, it will not absorb at all, non-adsorbing. In other words, we say that this particular analyte A2 does not it cannot adsorb on the stationary phase. If that happens, what will be the time at which it appears at the end of the column? It will be very similar to the residence time of the liquid, okay. And on the contrast side, if you have a chemical which has very high this thing, it will not come out for a long time. Will it come out at all? Why will it come out?
Complete exhaustion.
Exhaustion.
Exhaustion of solid.
Yeah, but if exhaustion of solid means it is completely saturated with A, but that is not useful to us. No? So, now you have to go back to your analysis method. What are we talking about analysis? In your analysis, what is the sample? Is your sample an infinite sample or a finite sample? It is a finite volume, which means I only have this much. This is my sample done, 1 ml or 20 ml or 10 ml or whatever it is. And if you add this, what is going to happen? Will it ever come out? It will adsorb. Say there are two compounds A1 and A2, all the A2 comes out, it does not adsorb, A2 comes out. A1 is sitting inside the column, in this column, will it come out? So there is a continuous flow of mobile phase, which is a solvent, continuously, there is Q that is going through continuously, and in the middle of that, you add this little amount of your thing and you continue the flow. So let's look at this process again. So you have the solids here. I'm sending in some particles. These are the say molecules of A that enter in the flow. The moment they enter, they adsorb here in the beginning. And then it is all gone, all the A is all here now, there is no A here. What is coming here? It is pure mobile phase. When it crosses this one, what will happen? It will desorb, then go on to the next one, it will adsorb again here. This band, a few of these chemicals will desorb and go again here, because it is not in equilibrium. When a pure chemical solvent comes, this is not in equilibrium with the solvent anymore. See, you still have to follow this partitioning. When it is mixed initially, it has some concentration and it partitions in and it goes in and it keeps partitioning until the concentration is zero. So very high partitioning here, but when you send in pure solvent, the equilibrium is reversed. The driving force is now in this direction from solid to the mobile phase. It will come out and then go to the next layer of the solid, but the next layer of solid is empty, so it will adsorb there and so on. So this process continues, it goes from here to here to here to here to here. So this band of yellow moves it up, sorry. This band of yellow moves here, then after some time. So this is at, say at some time T1, T2, T3, T4, it moves through. One of the things you will notice is that when it moves through, it is not, the width of this thing is not the same. You will see it slightly expanded. It is expanded because there are multiple chemicals that are sitting in, all of them do not have the same partitioning constant, they go in and come out. So give you an analogy to this, say 15 of group of people go into a shopping mall, an arcade. You know what an arcade is? Arcade is an older systems, wherein there were no malls, there used to be a long list of shops. These are all shops, let us say this is the entry, 10 people get in here, who will come out first? You only can go in one direction. Who will come out first? Somebody who has no interest in shopping will come out first, which means there is no affinity towards the shopping, they like to get out. Somebody who likes to shop a lot will get in and get out of every shop and will take the longest to come out. Some of them will have relatively lower affinity, but they will still go in and come out. So you will see that based on this affinity for whatever is there on this side on the walls, you will, different groups will appear at different times. There will be one group that will appear at, so if I am standing outside, I am counting, and I am counting, I have a distribution. Group number 1 comes out at time t1, group number 2 comes out at time t2, group number 3 comes out at time t3, and so on, t4. All of them go in at the same time here. There are big chunk that are going in here, yeah, but there is a distribution at which they come out. This is your chromatogram essentially. So what are we doing here? We are sending in a bulk and we are counting as they are coming out at different times, okay. So we have to count. How do we count? That is our analytical, this is really the analytical instrument that is, this is doing separation and this is doing the counting. This is actual thing that is counting. So you have to find an instrument that will count whatever is coming from the chromatography. Then it will count, the instrument that you use for counting is based on how this sample is. It is a gas sample, liquid sample, what kind of organic compounds are coming. Based on that you can select different types of counters. So this process is different from this, and there is a sample introduction. Phase that. So what can you, how can you influence the separation here in a real sense, not in the not in this example. So if I want to separate, let us say that this group includes 2 or 3 different chemicals. If I want to further refine it, I have to find out a way in which you can separate this chromatogram, can be made into smaller groups. So that you have more resolution, more. So we will talk about this in the next class.